Blackstone Audiobooks presents
The Magna Charta by James Daugherty. Prologue. The Magic Island. There is in the North Atlantic a certain fair island called Britain. It was once a part of Europe, till an encircling sea 9,000 years ago angrily bit through the connecting lowlands and rushed through a channel, which is so narrow that at certain times and places, when the air is clear, one can see from shore to shore. The sea that mourns and crashes on its coasts has cast its spell over the land and its history. Across its moors and forests the sea mist drifts greyly, shrouding strange shapes in vagueness and wonder. Oak and beech, springing from the damp earth, covered the island with noble green forests where the nightingale sings. Placid rivers wind through flower-strewn meadows gently to the sea. Briefly, the sun shines through the misty air, touching the hills and the drifting cloud-rack with gold. Then again the fog rolls in, veiling the dripping forests and the lush green land with mystery and awe. Before the time of recorded history, the Druid priests raised great stones in a mystic circle to the sun and stars on lonely moors, and stained their altars with human blood in dreadful sacrifices. Ancient legends tell of how, on moonlight nights, King Arthur and his knights in shining mail rode through the forest glades where Oberon and Titania held their fairy court, and Brown Puck lurked grinning among the ferns. On stormy nights the old Norse goblins rode their demon horses down the screaming gale. Here the white unicorn with golden horn browsed on the flower-strewn grass, and lovely Una, with her guardian lion, shunned the scaly dragon breathing flame. Here men have heard unearthly music and woven legends into measured rhythms, and here great poets have sung immortal songs. Ever since the dim ages when restless tribes first wandered across Europe, men have coveted this island paradise with a deep desire. For hundreds of years the invaders, wave upon plundering wave, swept down upon her low-lying shores and, sailing up her rivers, drove deep into the heart of the land, slaying and burning. Celt and Briton, Pict and Roman, Saxon and Viking, Dane and Norman, landed and ravaged and settled in the land through long centuries. Gradually these people, conquerors and conquered, mingled and became one race, and the mixture is richer for what each has brought. In spite of wars and cruel oppressions, there has always remained an unquenchable love of liberty and justice in the heart of this race. Because of this, in the course of centuries, slowly, with long delays and many reverses, yet persistent and enduring, this people has framed a way of government which has made and kept them the freest people on earth. When these restless children of the Northmen and Vikings perilously crossed the Western Sea and peopled the continental wilderness of North America, they brought with them their precious heritage of freedom. When danger to these rights and liberties threaten us from without or from within, we, the English-speaking people, remember our hard-won heritage of freedom, and stand together dauntless and unsubdued until the victory is won and the storm is past. Twice in our century has this, our heritage, been in deadly peril, and has been preserved at untold cost. When we know the story of how our liberties were won and at what price, we will value and guard them, for they are not ours alone. They bear no national label. They belong to all mankind. Part 1. The 12th Century. Living in the 12th Century. If you were living in the 12th century in England, you would be somebody's vassal. Nearly everybody in the 12th century was someone's vassal. The king and the bishops were the pope's vassals. The barons and even many bishops were the king's vassals. The knights were the barons' vassals. The farmers were the knights' tenants, and the labourers, or villeins, as they were called, were the vassals of practically everybody. In particular, you would be the vassal of your lord, the baron on whose estate you lived and worked. You would have a special occupation with special duties, and as such you would have certain rights and privileges. But you would never have heard of freedom of speech, freedom of religion, freedom from want, or freedom from fear. You could not leave your baron's estate without his permission. Very probably you would not know.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.